So let's talk about the future. Without some kind of time machine, we can't know what's going to happen in the years to come. But that doesn't stop us from thinking and wondering and planning. We make predictions about everything. Not just things like hoverboards and dehydrated pizza, but also about language. How it'll change, what we'll be speaking, and even how many languages we'll even have. And we've been doing this for ages. People in the past made predictions about their future, which is our present. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
When we want to make predictions about the future of language, a good place to start is by thinking about the past. And I mean exactly that. Let's talk about what some people think might happen with the past tense in English. The general rule for English past tense is pretty straightforward. Take that ed and slap it on the end of a verb, and then it'll change pronunciation to t, dr, id, depending on what the verb ends in. That's how the morpheme works. But of course, English is a natural language, and natural languages, they're not clean. So we've got oodles of exceptions to account for in the English past tense. Go becomes went, not goed. Been turns to bent, not bended. Think goes to thought, and many, many more. And all of those have to be accounted for. When we learn the past tense of English, we also need to memorize all those exceptions, or we're not going to fit into our linguistic communities. Here's the thing, though. There used to be a lot more exceptions. If you think English has a lot of irregular verbs to keep track of now, we used to have nearly twice as many. From the ones that we have on record, we've dropped from 177 exceptions down to 98. Like, in 1500, no one would have said Lorraine helped Calvin inside, because the past tense of help wasn't helped, it was holp. But now help is all normal, and so are laughed, walked, and many more. Wouldn't it be cool if we could predict what other verbs were going to fall in line and become regular? Like, look it up in some future almanac and know the fate of English. Well, some real predictions have been made for what changes we might see in a 2007 paper published in Nature. See, unlike the regular rule which we internalize when we're tiny, wug-loving toddlers, all the irregulars have to be memorized. And to memorize them, you need to hear them enough to know that they should be irregular. That might be easy with things like have or say, where we hear them all the time. But words that aren't as common are in danger of having their weird forms get forgotten and just fade away into nothingness. Take something like cleave. If you were going to use the word at all, you'd probably say you cleaved some meat for dinner, right? Not cleft? Cleft is the old irregular form for it, but it's mostly gone now. The researchers in the study looked at the rate of use of verbs that have changed in the past, and found that English regularizes them at a rate that is inversely proportional to the square root of their usage frequency. So something that's used 100 times less often will become just a regular verb 10 times as fast. And working with this formula and a lot of data, they made some predictions about what's most likely to fall out of English over the next century or two. Smite will lose its irregular smote and leave behind smited, and wed will get divorced from, well, wed and just be wedded. Will that prediction work out? Well, again, we can't really know. We do know that languages have lost bigger things over time. English itself has lost gender marking on nouns and the ability to order words in pretty much any way it pleases. Japanese has lost two of its regular verb classes and merged some of its tenses together. Mandarin lost the ability to stick regular stops like p, t, and k at the end of syllables in the coda. Lots and lots can happen. Of course, the biggest thing that can happen is for languages to just die out completely. It's hard to get an exact count of the number of languages that exist now or that existed even a few decades ago, but there's no question that we've been losing languages to extinction at an alarming rate. Once there are no more speakers of a language, that's pretty much it for its future. Even if we can't determine the precise number of languages that exist, because that gets into defining dialects versus languages and other thorny issues, we can say there's around 6,000 or 7,000 languages left. If we look at Ethnologue, a database of languages from around the world, they list 7,102 at present. Some other sites, like the Endangered Language Fund, cite about 6,000, so that's about the right ballpark. Well, linguists have predicted that about half of these languages, or 3,000 or so, are virtually guaranteed to go extinct over the next century. And it's not hard to find estimates that go way beyond that. John McWhorter said earlier this year, for example, that he forecasted a drop of 90% in the number of the remaining languages in the world in 100 years. That's a huge, huge drop, almost unimaginably big. Let's put this into perspective with an example country, Paraguay. Paraguay is in the center of South America, and it's an interesting place linguistically, with a very vibrant population speaking an indigenous language, Guaraní, as well as Spanish, among many others. It's not a huge country, though, with about 6.5 million people. Now, how many endangered languages would you predict there'd be in a country this size? Well, Ethnologue lists 24 languages in use currently in Paraguay, and of those, 12 are vulnerable to extinction. So there's your 50%. Some, like Guana, already have no monolingual speakers left, and under 100 speakers overall. That's really hard to come back from. There's a lot of information like this, and it's easy to search through. For example, UNESCO has a really engrossing interactive atlas where you can search by country or by level of endangerment. But can we really say that all of these languages are destined to fade out with no roads to the future? Well, for many it really may be too late. But there are a lot of efforts at revitalizing languages, for example, the RNLD, or Resource Network for Language Diversity. So for some of the languages, if we work on it and try to change, hopefully they can be saved. What's leading to this huge dying off of languages? Well, there are a lot of factors, and we'll put some links in the video description to the discussions of those in more detail. But one big factor is the perceived utility of the languages on the part of the people learning them or teaching them to their kids. Kids acquiring the language are the lifeblood of any linguistic community. They're the future generation of speakers, after all. And parents want to give their kids a boost and make their way in the world easier. In many cases, unfortunately, that doesn't include picking up these endangered languages. This is a real tragedy, since multilingual acquisition doesn't hurt kids, but it is part of what's going on in a complex situation. Turning away from that discussion, and seriously, take a look at some of the links down in the description if you're interested, we can look at a related issue, a world language. If the number of languages is shrinking, and people want to learn something that will let them communicate with anyone, are we all going to end up speaking the same language at some point? It's not hard to find predictions online that in the future we'll all be speaking Mandarin or English. How likely is that to come to pass? Well, again, it's impossible to know. But we here at the Ling Space are somewhat skeptical about this. Concentrating everyone into one particular language, no matter how many people speak it, seems kind of unlikely. Everyone is a lot of people, and the world's a big place. What seems more likely to us is people clustering around a number of different hub languages that they see as being useful. Someone from Peru might find different languages useful than someone from Laos, or from, say, Libya. For a lot of people, that language might be English, or maybe Mandarin, but for others, maybe it'll be Spanish, or Russian, or Japanese. That's the finding from a 2014 paper, which looks at what languages are connected by people who translate books, edit Wikipedia, or use Twitter. The idea is that these are activities that someone will probably only do if they're pretty solid in both languages. And then they linked up these different linguistic co-expressions into networks to see what languages are likely to pair up, like which languages people are more likely to be bilingual in. And yes, English does show up quite a lot, as you'd expect. There's lots of writing, online and off, happening in English. But other significant hubs do exist, around Portuguese, Chinese, German, and more. These intermediate networks represent lots of people who view these languages as being useful. Of course, it's not possible to know the future. We don't have a working DeLorean to take us around, and we can't see where things are going to be in 30 years, much less later. But we can make some solid predictions about where things are going to go. Some of these outcomes are good, and some are bad, and some are kind of neither. But our linguistic futures are what we make of them. So let's get traveling and see what we can do. Great Scott! We've reached the end of the Ling Space for this week. If you correctly predicted what I was going to say, you learned that the English past tense may get even more regularized than it is already, that many languages spoken in the world today are predicted to die off in the coming century, and that we may end up with a global language, but it's more likely there'll be a bunch. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Delélise Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our editor is Georges Coulomb, our production assistant is Stéphane Hurtubise, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website, where we'll have some extra materials on this topic. Also, try dropping by our store, where we have the prettiest IPA poster ever. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling Space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Yayo Tobata!